Hi, LinkedIn friends. This is Dorie Clark, and I'm really excited to be here with my good friend, Alisa Cohn. And we are going to be talking today about how to become a recognized expert. And specifically, I'm going to be talking to Alisa about her journey in becoming a recognized expert herself and the points along the road. Alisa, thanks so much for joining us.
Oh my God, so fun to be here with you, Dorie Clark.
Oh, that's great. So, yeah, Alisa, you have had a really great journey over the past few years, which I want to dig into, because one of my philosophies around becoming a recognized expert is that often I think a problem that we have in society, I guess you could say, is the way that the story gets told, because people often see people who are successful and they assume either that that person has always been like very famous since the beginning of time, or that suddenly a miracle happened and there was a bolt from heaven and it just happened like magic. But that's not necessarily true. And so I would love to hear from you. I know that specifically around, let's say 3 or 4 years ago, you had built up a really solid business, but you hadn't spent nearly as much time on your brand. And I know that you made a conscious decision that you wanted to. Can you talk about that decision and why you thought that that was important?
Well, it was definitely inspired by you, Dorie, because we were talking about this in the context of your Recognized Experts formula, and really the whole notion of like building my brand in order to get more business to me, coming to see me. I am really good at reaching out and finding business. And also I'm really good at getting referrals from the, you know, sort of my many very satisfied customers, but I realized I was missing a plank. And I realized that by building my brand, I could fill that plank. And so I decided that it was time to be concentrated, to have a concentrated effort to really be focused on building my brand and building my profile.
That makes sense. So what were the first things that you started to do? Like how does one, if they have this realization that it's important to start building your brand as a recognized expert, how would one get started? And specifically, how did you get started?
Well, just to say that I already was building a strong network. That comes naturally to me, to build the network of people around me to help me, to refer me. What I realized, I need to do two more things. I need to build social proof, and I needed to kind of have my content out there. Those are kind of, this, in some ways, of course, they're linked. But social proof was about making sure that I had strong testimonials, that I was working for very high profile clients, and finding ways to have relationships with those high profile clients so that, you know, it would be like, oh, well, if Google hired her, you know, she must be great. If Pfizer hired her, she must be great. Bloomberg I worked for. So those kinds of companies were significant. And then equally, I began to write. So first I wrote for my own blog, and then I wrote for other kind of easy to get into publications. And then I decided that I really wanted to focus on more of a name brand publication. So on the back of the writing I had already done, I was able to kind of work my way into more high profile publications to write for.
Yeah, that's really interesting, Alisa. Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing that. That's great. And I'll also mention too, if you guys are out here watching, I'd love to see who is here in the audience. We are happy to take questions as well for Alisa. So please feel free to type into the chat box and say hi to let us know who you are and where you're from. We'd love to hear that. And so Alisa, you raise what I think is a really important point, which is that you mentioned that your network was pretty strong, but that the other aspects of becoming a recognized expert, your social proof and your content creation, were less strong. And I have often found that in people who are mid-career professionals, senior professionals, they often have kind of over-indexed in one area that is comfortable for them, and they haven't done as much in other areas. And so I think that's really interesting. I see Nihar is here from Dallas. Hi,
okay,
Nihar.
Thanks for joining us. Thanks for signing. Thanks
for joining us. Welcome. Yes. So Alisa, I know that once you got serious about becoming a recognized expert and really sharing your content, your ideas, one of the first places that you broke in, I mean, now You write for Harvard Business Review. You write for Forbes. You write for Inc., and which is fantastic. You're creating a ton of content. I know that one of the very first places that you started writing for was Worth Magazine. And I am really curious if you can tell us that story, because I think it's very illustrative about approaches that often work when it comes to breaking in as a recognized expert.
Definitely. I'm going to tell you that story. I just first want to mention, I want to comment on what you said, that people will do kind of the thing that they maybe they will do, that they will over index on the things they feel comfortable with. That is so true. And also the things they enjoy. So an example is, yes, I enjoy networking. I enjoy meeting new people. I also easily get referred to new people. It was easy for me. It took a lot of time. It was good work, but I didn't make time before I started making time. I did not make time to build content. And that is the point that you really have to, I think, assess yourself and realize, like, okay, I'm missing a plank here. And even if I don't love it, it doesn't come naturally to me, or I'm not quite sure what to do, I need to make time for it. So that on the topic of Worth, I had already done some writing on my own blog, a lot of writing. I had done a lot of newsletters over the years, which, by the way, really intimidated. Like, I was always so afraid of sending my newsletter out to my clients and to other people. So that was kind of nerve wracking. And then I had written like a few articles here and there for some sort of publications. And I was at one of the clubs that I'm a member of, and I was invited to a private dinner because I know I like these kinds of things. And wouldn't you know, it was hosted by the publisher of Worth. And so, you know, there I was with these 12 people, and luckily there was a table question, and luckily there was all a very small group, and we had all chatted with each other a little bit, which warmed it up. So I went to approach the publisher before the end of the dinner, before we all left, and said, I would love to talk to you about writing for your leadership column at Worth. And he was very receptive. He was very receptive to it, but I want to say that I had also figured out from the conversation that he felt they were missing women's voices. And so I felt especially encouraged to go and approach him, like, okay, I'm going to take this opportunity to go talk about my woman's voice and also my expertise in leadership. So I approached him. He said, great. I reached out to him the next day. I did not hear back. So I reached out to him again a week later, and he sent me to somebody else. So I reached out to the somebody else, and she did not get back to me. And so I re-reached out, and I prodded her again. And then we finally had a chat on the phone to talk through my credentials and what I could write about. And that's how it all, and then it was a few tryouts, and that was fine. But that's how it all started. And it really took a lot for me to both kind of screw up my courage to go ask. And also, I'm very good at follow up, but that was like very intimidating follow up. But I'm like, I'm committed and I'm going to do it.
Yeah, that's such an important story, Alisa. And I'll actually just mention, by the way, if any of you guys have questions for Alisa, please feel free to type them into the chat box, because we want to get to your questions as well. But before we do, just to highlight some important things. Number one, I love just the persistence and the determination in your story. So many people, so often, we psych ourselves out and we say, oh, well, he must not be getting back to me because he thought about it and he decided that he doesn't want anything to do with me. Or maybe he looked me up and then he decided that I wasn't good enough.
Yes.
And they stop. And the truth is, it's just that people are busy and people are flaky, and you have to badger them a few times to get them to actually do what they said they're going to do.
Yes. And email overwhelm is a real thing. So I would say, for me, to everybody out there listening, think about this. You're doing them a favor. They actually want to get back to you. And then their email goes down, just like your email goes down to the bottom, and it goes to the next page and the next page. When you ping it back up, not the very next day, not an hour later, but multiple days later or early next week, when you ping them back, it reminds, oh yeah, I gotta get back to her. And it helps them be successful and do the thing they said they would do. It helps them maintain their integrity. And that is literally how I think about it. And I encourage you to think about it that way too.
I love that. That's great. And for those of you that are trying to think, well, you know, how can I figure out where I'm stronger or where I'm less strong in terms of becoming a recognized expert? One thing I want to mention to you guys, I have a free toolkit, a free resource called the Recognized Expert Self-Assessment Toolkit. that actually gives you a numerical score. You take a test, you get a numerical score that helps you think through where to focus in your recognized expert efforts. And that's available at dorieclark.com/toolkit.
I used that and I found that very helpful. And I shared it with other people. And it's really incredible because it's actually, it's very simple, but it's very useful to kind of assess, like, where am I over-indexing or under-indexing? And I bet everybody will find themselves not so balanced. And that's not bad. That's just a diagnostic. Just
absolutely.
Like, oh, good. Now I've got to solve this problem. It's really helpful.
Yeah. Thank you, Alisa. And I just want to greet some of the great folks that are here. Darren is here from Franklin, Tennessee. Hey, Darren, so nice to see you here. We have Matthew from Bend, Oregon. David is here from Ottawa. Greg is here from Milton, Mass. That's right. You're hanging out with Deval Patrick. That's great. Antara is here from Chicago. Mika is here all the way from Japan. Welcome, Mika. Carlos, our faithful LinkedIn live friend, is here from Colombia. Our mutual friend, Alisa, Erica Keswin, author Erica Keswin, is here from Kent, Connecticut. Barbara's here from the Gulf Coast. Demetria from Virginia. That's wonderful. And we have anonymous LinkedIn user from New York City. So I don't know who that is. That's very exciting.
It's a question, anonymous. We want to answer your question.
I know. That's so great. Is it Michael Bloomberg? I don't know. It really could be anybody. So yeah. I like that very much. So yes, please feel free, guys, to type your questions for Alisa into the chat box if you'd like. And be sure also open a new window in your browser to make sure you're following Alisa on LinkedIn. She's very popular and you'll want to follow her because she has all kinds of good information that she shares. So yes, of course. So Alisa, now I want to move along a little bit in your recognized expert journey. Oh, and actually there's one other thing I want to say too, which is, people might think in hearing your story, right? People think a lot of things. And one thing they might say is, well, Alisa, you got to go to a private dinner with this guy that ran Worth Magazine. Yeah. I don't belong to a club where I could go to a private dinner with this guy. So talk a little bit about that, because I believe that there is a useful lesson here for everybody. And I'm happy to didactically make that point, but I'm sure you have some thoughts about that as well.
Well, I want to just say that I first heard about the Core Club in the New York Times article, and the headline may just as well have been, "This is a club that Alisa Cohn, you will never be able to join." Like, that's what it felt like. I was like, oh, I would never do anything glamorous. And I kind of moved to New York to do glamorous things, and I would never be able to do that. And I kept it in my mind for years. And then I ran into my friend Gorjot, who said, and we were driving somewhere, and she said something, the Core Club. I said, do you remember the Core Club? She said, yeah. I said, oh, I've heard of the Core Club. I've always wanted to be a member. She said, oh, I can sponsor you. And I mean, that was it. Like, suddenly that New York Times headline was, Alisa, you are allowed to join. So I want everyone to really see that we all have our blockers about whatever. And sometimes it really takes your own, like, working through it to be able to join a club. And then, listen, it was expensive. I made an investment, and it was an expensive investment. But at the same time, I kind of decided it would be very helpful for me professionally and probably personally. And so I decided to join that club. And then I didn't just join that club. I got involved in that club because I recognized that part of what I wanted to do was to meet the other people who were members of that club. Remember that New York Times article? Remember, like, oh, there's like really significant people here that I wanted to bring into my network. And so I got involved, and I also figured out, like, what are the keys to getting involved here? It didn't just happen. I didn't just show up every other Monday, right? Like, I really made it a project of how do I kind of figure out how to make use of this club, because, you know, it was expensive. And that's the other thing, is that you just decide where to invest your money. And I'm not, you know, like this high flyer private jet person. So just to say, like this is the kind of thing, if I can do it, anyone can do it.
That's a fantastic point. I love it. Yeah. And I also, a related point, which I'll add to it, is that because most of us are sort of strong in, let's say, one area of being a recognized expert, the interesting thing is that you can leverage that area to help you in the other areas. So in Alisa's case, she was strong in networking. And yeah. so she leveraged her network to help her break into the thing that she wanted to do, which was content creation and social yeah. proof in terms of writing for Worth. But so for yeah. you, let's pretend, you know, you out there watching, maybe you're strong somewhere else. Maybe you're strong in content creation already, but your network isn't very good. Well, guess what? You can start interviewing people. And that's a great way to leverage content to build your network. So it works in all different kinds of directions.
Yeah, definitely. The last thing I want to say about the whole network thing is I wasn't born with a strong network, right? I was able to literally practice my social skills. And I mean that literally. When I was early on in my career, I kind of saw like, oh, social skills are important. Network is important.
You're just a girl from Holliston, Massachusetts.
I know. I'm just a girl from a small town. And so I had to really practice that. And at first I was kind of bad. I would practice like going to cocktail parties and like it didn't go very well. It was really uncomfortable. And then over time, I got better at it and better at it and better at it. By the time I approached the core club and sort of thought about it, for me, it was like an interesting puzzle. Like, how am I going to crack this code? And I was still a little nervous, but I was not nearly as intimidated as I would have been if I hadn't built my skills. I think all of us need to see that everything that you're talking about, everything that we do, is just a skill to build. And by the way, when you start building a skill, you're going to be bad. So be bad, and then you get mediocre, and then you get good.
I think that's fantastic. So to yeah. that point, Darren actually has a question. And I'll just say our faithful friend John has texted me this question. And John, I have an amazing announcement for you, which is StreamYard suddenly, literally today, allows you to see LinkedIn comments. So you actually don't even have to text me more comments. But thank you for doing that. We're grateful.
But John wants to be part of this party.
It's true. If John wants to text me, like, you know, gifts, that's okay. Like, whatever John wants to text me is fantastic, but he does not have to text me questions. So thank you though for that. So Darren's question, which I can amazingly see in front of me, this is like a new innovation in LinkedIn Live. Darren wants to know, how do you decide how to balance your focus in the different recognized expert areas, which is a very good question. So how do you think that through, Alisa?
Well, I did use your diagnostic. I mean, at one point, you know, we're friends. And so I sort of said, oh, Dorie, can you answer this question for me? And she said, you know, you should look at my diagnostic. And I thought, all right, okay. So I did. And it was super helpful to really.
You thought I was totally dissing you. I'm like, talk to the diagnostic, Alisa.
Exactly. Like you can ask me questions, but after you fill out my form, I'm like, okay, I'll fill out your form. That's what friends are for. But, you know, it gives you this sense of like, oh, you're super strong here and you're less strong here. So that's one way. I would just add, you probably have your own sense of what you're missing, right? So there are people who I know who are busy writing content for high profile publications. And like, that's really working for them, but they're not getting out of sort of their homes metaphorically. We're still locked down here, but out of their homes metaphorically to network with other people, and they're not challenging themselves to network people who make them uncomfortable. And the last thing I would say is whatever it is makes you most uncomfortable, that's probably where you need to look.
Yeah, that's really helpful, Alisa. And I also just want to return, it occurs to me, to a point that you made earlier talking about the core club experience, yeah. which is that I think when it comes to network building, one of the important lessons that I've certainly tried to fulfill, and I think your example is a really good one, is whenever you break into a new network, it really pays to go all in with that yeah. network, because yeah. it does not matter if you are a member of 10 things and you never participate and you're kind of half-assed about it, because yeah. people won't remember you. It almost doesn't count. But if you take one or two things that you get into, and hopefully it should be the kind of ripest, you know, highest profile, best thing that you can get into. But if you get into a thing that's good, you want to maximize that. And so, yeah. you know, if you join the core club, make the membership count. Don't just pay them the money and hope things will happen. Dive yeah. in, get involved. The same is true. Many of you guys who are actually tuning in now are actually current members or new members of the Recognized Expert community. And this is a perfect example where if you join the Recognized Expert course and community, one of the very best aspects of the course is the people that you meet as part of it. And so interacting on the online community, diving in, you know, setting up one-on-one calls with people, you know, raising your hand and saying, hey, that was really interesting. Let's connect. That's one of the ways that you can maximize the value of your participation in the course and community, because people will get to know you. And the more they know who you are and what you do, the more opportunities they will think of for you.
Yeah, I really agree with that, Dorie. And I would just add, if I think about my own experiences in the recognized expert community, it's already a group of people who are kind of have the same values and want the same things. And Dorie, you've done a great job of making the community very welcoming, very let's help each other place. And so the combination of that is a very, very powerful kind of petri dish of like all these different molecules cross-pollinating, people helping each other, and people kind of rising together. And also, I think natural mentors emerging from different areas. So it's an extremely fruitful experience to get involved.
That's great. And here's Nihar. He's providing affirming statements to us. He says, great point. Make the membership count. Thank you, Nihar.
Yep. Nihar's a strong member.
We love that. We love that. So Alisa, let's trace it back too, because okay, you're now writing for Worth, which is fantastic, but I know you also successfully broke in at other publications. So for instance, you write for Inc. Maybe you can talk a little bit, and I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that your network was also crucial for that as well. Would you mind telling us the story about how you got connected and started to write for them?
Yeah, so first of all, after writing for Worth for a period of time, not even that long, I was lucky enough to get introduced to somebody at Forbes in the leadership group, and on the strength of both my newsletters, which I never really wanted to write, I was so nervous, and also a number of now published articles in Worth, I was accepted into Forbes, which is fantastic. So then I was writing a column in Forbes, and that was very, very mainstream, very accessible, very, you know, sort of status, and so that was a good thing. And then I was in the first cohort of the Marshall Goldsmith 100 Coaches.
And so, what is that, Alisa?
So that is Marshall Goldsmith, the top executive coach on the planet, has gathered the world's leading coaches and other sort of top executives into this wonderful community. Again, a pay it forward community. So Marshall's brought us together and we're all learning together. And Marshall's point is, I'm doing all this for you for free so that you will pay it forward. So it's also a very generous and a very, you know, networking-y community. So through that, I met the publisher of Inc. And when I talked about the writing for Forbes and writing for other publications, and he said, well, you should be writing for us. So I thought, well, that sounds very good. The very next day, an editor at Inc. reached out to me to have me kind of fast track through the application. And just to say that application is a thing. It is an endurance contest to get through it.
It's an elaborate application, yes.
What'd you say?
It's an elaborate application.
Yes, it is. But because I had this, you know, sort of network affiliation, I was able to get that fast tracked. And that was really, really very powerful. So it was like a lot of things coming together. Yeah, a lot of things coming together.
That's fantastic. So I love the points there. And I'll just mention too, if you have questions for Alisa, please feel free to type them into the chat box. We want to get to your questions as well. But a couple of things that I just wanted to draw out, Alisa, that I love. So after a while, we start with your network and you leverage your network to break into Worth. You start writing for them. And so you're creating content, but you also are garnering social proof as a result because people are saying, oh, she writes for Worth. And so meanwhile, by the time you get to the guy who's the publisher of Inc. and you say, well, I write for Worth, I write for Forbes. He says, oh, you should write for us. He doesn't say, are you any good? Let me evaluate closely to see if you are worthy. He assumes that you are good because you have the social proof of the other brands already behind you.
Definitely. If anything, he felt competitive. Like, how dare you write for them and not write for us? Yeah. That, yes to all that. And as a result of writing for those publications, just as one example, IBM reached out to me just on the strength of some things I had written, asking me to speak as a keynote at one of their conferences just last fall.
Like, so, back when we could travel, yes.
I was like wondering, like, when was that? Like, I got in a plane. I can't remember.
Sometime right? before and, March.
Yeah. So just to say that, like, that was all the, that's part of that. So I was mentioning social proof. So you have the social proof, and then you get more social proof, and then you get more. So it kind of all adds up, and you continue to expand your network as you go as well. These things do interlock.
Yeah, definitely. That's great. So our mysterious LinkedIn user does have a question. Thank you, LinkedIn user. That's amazing. We're trying to extrapolate. This is kind of like a game of charades. We're trying to extrapolate from your question.
It's definitely Andrew Cuomo. It's definitely Governor Cuomo. That's what
I think.
Yeah.
Well, that's very nice.
Career leader. Yeah.
Yes. So our special LinkedIn user wants to know, what would you advise to a mid-career leader about spreading their wings into the Rex areas? And does a lack of experience, for example, not, I guess, if you're mid-career, but you haven't been, you know, if you're not senior, if you don't have 20 plus years, does that make a difference?
Well, I'd like to answer that because I think that's where the formula really helps. So if you're trying to switch careers completely, wow, you need to really quickly gather the right network, the right social proof. And part of that is by content creation. And part of that is by talking to people in the field, maybe interviewing them. Interviewing people in the field you want to switch to weirdly paints you immediately as an expert. Like, that's one important thing to say. The second thing to say is that you then also have the opportunity to network with those folks in that particular industry. They point you in the right direction. They're also, because you've interviewed them for some publication, they kind of feel like they owe you something, and you get to know those people and also position yourself as an expert, even without any experience, but certainly not, you don't need 20 years of experience. By the way, you should then learn your craft. It's just responsible.
Yes, exactly. I love it. Yeah, that's great. And Darren is rocking out on this message. He says, it's the power of compounding investment and building your REC status. That's right, Darren. Yes. Exactly. Darren's on the pathway. Darren's been published in HBR. So good.
Excellent.
Good job, Darren.
Good job, Darren.
Yes. So we have a question. We're wrapping at 9, so we're getting ready to come to a close shortly. We have time for probably one more question. And I will just mention, too, for those of you guys who are on the call, many of you who are joining us actually are new members in our Recognized Expert community. So we really want to welcome you to that. It's a fantastic community, and we're really excited to dive into it with you. But if you are watching this and you are considering joining the course, the registration ends tonight. It ends in 3 hours from now. And so I'll just mention, I'll type into the chat box what that link actually is. It is learn.dorieclark.com/courses/expert. You can see that in the chat box from me if you are interested in joining. And so the last question, Alisa, comes from Booyan, and he wants to know, how did you decide on what topics to write for these publications? How do you do that?
It's a very, very good question. And by the way, it's not so easy. You have to actually sit back and say, gosh, what should I write about? So when I first talked to the person at Worth, we sort of brainstormed a list, but she asked me to come up with a list. So I looked at Worth and I saw what they were already writing about. I thought about my own. Oh, hi, Ashish. I looked at their publications and I thought about my own work and how I'd be able to fit in. When I started writing for Forbes, I started a lot with interviews, which kind of got me on my way, and also things I had pet peeves about. When I started writing for Inc., it was very inspiring to see what other people were writing about. And I found that that generated a lot of ideas. Oh, but last thing, many editors will brainstorm with you topics that then will be a good fit for you and for them.
Yeah, that's fantastic, Alisa. Thank you so much. And I really want to express my appreciation. Thank you for taking the time. Alisa was part of the pilot cohort of the Recognized Expert community back in 2016 when I launched the course. And she has really done the work, which is the most important part in becoming a recognized expert, is just persistently doing the work to level up. This is not about, oh, you do one thing and it's a grand slam.
No, you have to keep doing it.
It's single after single after single, but it begins to really add up.
And it really adds up. And I found that I found your course inspiring in terms of like helping you do the work, which is the most important thing, but also extremely clear. Here's the work you have to do.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. And Darren just chimed in. He said, if you're considering joining the Rex community, I highly recommend it. Thank you, Darren. I appreciate that very much. That's great. So guys, if you want to hear more from Alisa, make sure go ahead, open a new window in your browser and go to her LinkedIn profile and click follow to follow her.
And so you can see what I'm writing on Forbes and Inc. and all those other places. Yeah.
You can see exactly what topics she picks. Yeah. That's right.
There's an article coming out next week. You don't want to miss it.
Is it next week?
Next Tuesday. Oh,
fantastic. That is great.
Yeah.
That's excellent. Well, everyone, thank you so much. Have a great night and good luck with your recognized expert journey.
Bye, everyone.